So welcome to the fourth candle lecture. So tonight we have the privilege and honor to welcome Ibrahim Mahama. Thank you so much for being here with us. So Ibrahim is based in Ghana, now doing his PhD in fine art practice, but he's currently doing the DAAD residency in Berlin. So he will be sharing about his work, and I think, yeah, I don't need to say much more because you will do the job. But thank you so much for coming tonight and for sharing your work with us. Thank you.
Is there a microphone? Is this thing?
Yeah, that should be.
Anyway, thank you very much for inviting me to give this talk. I think it's always very refreshing to talk to students, particularly when you are still one yourself. So just to give you a brief background of my practice, I studied in Ghana at the Kwame Nkrumah University of Science and Technology. In the late 50s, it used to be the College of Arts and Technology. During that period, we had some of the early students who started the program at KNUSD. Then there was a College of Art in Ghana. Also came to the Slade Art School. So Ghana has quite a history with some of the schools in the UK, like with the Slade and Goldsmith, particularly during the 60s when you had the Cold Stream reforms and all that, like looking at the art curriculum within art universities. Ghana was one of the school in Kumasi was one of the schools that really adapted some of these forms and methods. And some of our students, particularly with the older generation, also went on to like have like very consistent practices and all that. I know sometimes it gets a bit, over time some of these histories get a bit lost, so I thought it would be somehow very important to mention that, given the fact that even now there's still a lot of students who have, let's say, undergraduate training in universities elsewhere and then still travel to these.
Can I adjust your mic?
Yeah, don't think. Yeah,
okay.
Better.
Okay, is this a lot better now?
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, good. Maybe I was whispering before. So I pretty much had my whole undergraduate studies at KNUSD between 2006 to 2010, and then I went back to the same university to do my MFA in painting and sculpture. The undergrad was also in painting and sculpture, but I think I majored in painting. There was something very interesting about the idea of studying painting itself. So the MFA was also in painting, and then after the MFA, I decided just to stay back and do the PhD in painting because, I don't know, sometimes as an artist, it seems that when we study one particular subject, and we have the opportunity to study something else, we always want to study something different because we think we have quite an experience in it. But in my case, I thought it was really important to somehow go back to the same thing over and over again because there's always something that you didn't quite get even within that time that you were dealing with it, whether it's at the undergrad level or the master's level. Yeah. So the very basis of my practice comes down to a series of ideas. I think I should hold this thing. Yeah. It's like I'm pulling my jacket. So it actually comes down to a series of ideas or thoughts that I've been working on during my undergrad days. As a painter, I was more interested in these sculptural forms, so I used to do a lot of collage. But the collage I was interested in the beginning were more to do with dealing with the idea of the body itself. So what I would do normally was that I used to make a plaster cast of the body. So I'd use plaster of Paris and I'll pour it over life models and I would take the mold and then make these casts out of it. But I was more interested in the history of the material itself and also of the forms that were created out of it. And earlier on when I was also doing it, because coming out from, let's say, the art school and wanting to practice in Ghana, it was a bit difficult given the fact that there were very few or little or no institutions available for art. Like unlike the UK, you have a lot of museums, a lot of galleries, a lot of non-profit spaces. Yeah, but in Ghana it was almost impossible to find spaces that can contain certain works or certain ideas. Because within a certain era, there were the idea of making a painting or sculpture or craft was very high, such in the sense that there were spaces like hotels and other institutions that had given out their lobbies and other spaces for the for art exhibitions and other things. And over a long period, it somehow became like the hegemony, the way that people, artists, when they were making work, they would think that at the end of the day, there were spaces that were already meant for it. So it somehow, I thought that it already limited ideas in terms of what could be possible, in terms of if the work could be material or immaterial in a sense. So I was already considering the fact that spaces in which work is exhibited should somehow be treated as equal as the work itself, the production of it, because the space itself somehow should become a material part of the art production. The reason why I show this image as the first image and kept it for a while is because later on, when I became a lot more interested in other subjects or other materials, I realized that some of the early thoughts I had in terms of the idea of the body and other things were things that were, because sometimes as an artist, you have an idea, but there, I don't know, there's fundamentally behind your brain, there is something a lot more deeper that lies, but at the point where you are working, you're still trying to grapple with this idea that you're working with. And most of the time it's because as artists, when you don't really have the chance to explore it further, it's very easy for you to somehow abandon the idea and say, oh, this has no good in it. But later on, when I started looking through the archives of research and other things I was doing, I realized that there was a strand of things or ideas that were running through. And this is practically the body of one of the conferences I worked with, as you see in later images. It's there. I come from the northern part of Ghana. And you know, historically, Ghana used to be a British colony, but before that, it used to be a colony of many other countries like Portugal, Denmark, Sweden. Yeah, it goes on and on. But the British stayed the longest. So, and within the British colonial period, that was when the railway system was built and a lot of other things. Also within that, that's when the most wars were fought. So a lot of Ghanaian territory was shaped actually during the British colonial era. And somehow, I think these things really go a long way in shaping my generations to come in terms of ideology, in terms of how people live within certain ethnic areas or states and all that. And we from the north, actually, the railway, when it was built, it was only built in the southern part of Accra, in the country, because most of the time you find out that you have a lot of mineral resources in the southern part. So you have a lot of gold, bauxite, manganese, and all these other minerals, timber. But in the north, it's a lot more dry, so the climate is a lot different. It's hotter. Of course, it has its own, I wouldn't go much deeper into the history. But the point is that when the railway was built, it was only built within these the southern parts of the country. So it never really connected to the northern parts, you know. And later on, when Ghana attained independence in 1957, there were plans by our first president to extend the railway to the northern side because he thought it was a time to unify the country beyond, because the railway was built specifically for exploitation. So it was only built in certain specific areas and regions. And in 1966, there was a coup d'etat, so most of these ideas were never realized. But at the same time, he, as a president, he was kind of a socialist, a Marxist. So he also had a very strong alliance with Eastern Europe within that time. So a lot of Ghanaian architecture in terms of monuments were also built together with either architects that were coming from Czechoslovakia or Poland or Ukraine or other places. So you find a lot of similarities in terms of buildings, states, housing, social housing and other things. The point was that there were other things also that were built, some which were like just purely infrastructural things, like the grain silos. All those images would come through to make a lot of sense. But the grain silos were some of the most important things that were supposed to have been built, because the point for the struggle for independence was geared towards this idea of like a certain kind of freedom, not just this symbolic freedom, but also a certain kind of economic emancipation, like through maybe development of certain infrastructures that could somehow help liberate some of these neocolonial tendencies and all that. And these superstructures which were built all around the country, but unfortunately in 1966, also when the coup happened, most of these things came to a halt. So over 60 years of history, most of these things, you see them actually exist around you, but they're almost like ghost structures. They're so imposing, but at the same time, you don't really even realize that they are there in the first place. So those are some of the things that my practice somehow deals with. These objects, structures, through architecture, and also just through like the body itself, people. Because the people in the north, a lot of them, when they're growing up, they come to the south to do a lot of old, odd jobs. They carry things from one point to the other and get paid pennies, and they sleep on the streets, mostly young women. And the point was that through the history, we have never really addressed some of these things, you know. And it's not just, I don't think it's just a Ghanaian problem. I think it's a worldwide problem in terms of looking at attitudes towards other states or other places, because when commodities somehow can almost be invisible and they can move from one space to the other, but a body that somehow labors for these things is so much very restricted when it's in its own zones. So the idea of the body comes back to this specific material, which was one of the materials that I decided to concentrate on in my practice, which is basically this jute sack, which is normally used in transporting cocoa from Ghana. But between Ghana and Cote d'Ivoire, I think we're the largest producer of cocoa in the world, which gives everyone their chocolates. So I think generally, if you're speaking, to speak on a much more political dimension, about 60% of the world's cocoa comes from these two countries. Let's say annually, if income is generated from it worldwide in terms of its value, it translates, into $200 billion. And the two countries only get $5 billion because the World Bank and the IMF makes it impossible for you to have industries that somehow give value to these things. So the farmers are not paying the right amount for their proceeds and blah, blah, blah. So at the end of the day, you still have like NGOs and all these institutions coming back to like give aid and all these things. So I think it's very, and a lot of the money that also comes from these commodities are used to build in certain infrastructures. So I think that when we think about architecture, we never really think about the relationship with architecture to other objects or other bodies. And for me, I think it was very important to somehow refer back to the objects or the things that have to decay in order for certain things to somehow strive or survive in a way. So this is just to show the idea of the material in terms of the container of it and how important that is. Yeah, so some of these images are actual. This is the first time actually I've ever shown images like this in my presentation. They're the worst I used to do when I was in my undergrad about 7 years ago. I used to have these exhibitions in my house at home, and I just hope that my neighbors will come and see it. It's not, you know, the point about making exhibitions is not about doing it in a grand style. It's just about making the point about the work itself. Yeah, I thought it was important somehow to open up, because it could have been in a gallery space, or it could have been in a museum, or it could have been somewhere that maybe art is supposed to be, but I thought that it's somehow important given this context and history that we could somehow open it. Yeah. So I did a lot of different experimentations in terms of looking at the form of the work and then what it could be, the body. Based on that, the new work that I started making by taking the material which I was exploring directly off the body and looking at another point, a significant point of it. Because the jute sacks I was working with in the beginning in relation to the body were, they were interesting, but they were not as interesting because they were not at a certain point in their life cycle that contained or had somehow gathered all the right amount of history and also aesthetics that you I needed. When I started working with this specific work of producing the monumental works, I started working with the jute sacks that have been used over and over again at a point where they have been used to transport charcoal. But the earlier ones I was working with, they were just jute sacks, yeah, and could have been anyone. But the later ones I started working with were specific points in the life of the material which had gone through a certain cycle. It had almost become a witness of all these different spaces, of all these different histories. And also because of the political context in which most of these things travel, it somehow gathered a certain kind of character which gave, which when combined with the labor that I was thinking of, created this really interesting form. So some of these images are archives from the Ghana Railway, dating back to some of the early workforce and all that. I'm always very much interested in these specific histories. This image refers to one of the grain silos in Ghana, in the eastern part. It was one of the silos that was never completed. There were a lot of different infrastructure. So some of them are very, very modernist. It comes back also to, I do a lot of research, so I always go from one space to the other. And, in 92, Ghana had a constitution, so that was the first time that we went to the polls. Before that, since 1966, we had a series of coups, so we had several military leaders until 92. So a lot of these things are also very important in terms of the specific histories and the aesthetics that it contributed to the country. I also became very much interested in some of the early objects in terms of the trains that were used for transportation of like commodities and other things and what they had turned into now. Yeah, so this is an image of the railway in Ghana. Yeah. So some of the images, they're like the workers. You quite don't understand what the image is. It's either workers are working in the railway yard, or they're tearing something apart. And in most cases, sometimes they're tearing something apart, and sometimes they're building. But the point about it is that there has been a lot of labor in terms of trying to restore some of these systems. And I think the restoration of it is always geared towards a certain kind of ideological break in terms of like people thinking about what the railway could actually represent post what it was constructed and built for and how it's contributed to like the geographical boundaries of the country. Yeah, so some of these are very old archival images that show of the trains that were brought into Ghana in the mid-50s. And some of them also date back to like the early 20th century in 1901. This is from Kassel in Germany. A lot of the trains that we use in Ghana were also produced there. The work that I produced for documented this year was actually in this particular railway, old train factory. And I think
think it was the first train manufacturing plant in Europe, but very little is known of it to date. Yeah. So Ghana also had a very famous sugar mill called Black Star Lines, and it also was used a lot in the importation of some of these trains and machines in the 50s. So I like to go back to some of these histories and ideas.
This is, I think, one of the most interesting images of this is that the Takra port is the second largest port in Ghana. And I think this is an earlier image, probably in the somewhere in the 1920s or so. Yeah. And it basically shows one of the train cars with, I don't know what exactly is in it, but either gold or oxide being transported into a British vessel. So and when you go to these spaces, you realize that a lot of these objects still exist, because my work has been based on a lot of these research, like in terms of even looking at the residues of history and all that, and how it's contributed to maybe specific aesthetics coming from certain specific places. And I thought it was somehow important to think about the history and language of photography in relation to other forms of art that are created. Yeah, so to make this one, varied things like drawings and some of the architectural forms, that in terms of the structure of the buildings themselves, were prefabricated and built. So this one, for instance, I think it's in Glasgow. Yeah, so before it was assembled in Ghana. So there are a series of images you'll see of the railway station, and these are all images coming from when these things were actually built in the UK. So this one, you find the inscription on it. So they are very, I think these are very, very important to somehow reflect upon in terms of looking at the general form and the aesthetics of the work, whatever it is, whatever form that it takes. Yeah, so now we come down to the work itself. Basically has two sets of images. They are all coming from the same space. One of it is it's coming from Kassel in Germany, and one of it is doing Documenta. That's the image on the right hand side when we were producing this work during the during Documenta. And my idea was to somehow re-engage with these specific spaces in which, let's say, certain machineries were produced. And that's what my practice has been about. It's about producing work, and the site of production itself is really important in terms of how the work takes its form and shape. So this space that we used in Documenta was once a train manufacturing site, and it was the same place where most of the trains which were manufactured were sent probably to India and other places. So I think it's very important in terms of trying to just deal with the ghost of these spaces, because now they're virtually empty. So when you encounter them, you somehow will reflect upon the significance of its history or how it's affected, let's say, the essence and the distribution of life itself. So I try to bring some of these objects back into the space and then re-engage with it through specific productions. Also through the collaborators, because there's a lot that happens. This is an image from Ghana during the production. We learned from Venice 2 years ago. So the collaborators that I've worked with, we've done a lot of different, not experiments per se, but I'm a person who likes to travel. I like to move from one place to the other. And I think that spaces are connected irrespective of whether through form or history, or whether just through the sheer language of it itself. So I started traveling from one place to the other. And that's where the idea of the studio lies, is somehow decentralized. So the studio is not really somewhere fixed. It could be anywhere. So I produce from bridges, railway stations. And the point is always about trying to connect or also engage with the workers or people working directly within those spaces, because the work deals with a certain physical labor.
And the label is very, very historical in terms of what it represents in human history. And not just human history, in terms of how human history also shapes other histories around us, the environment. And yeah, I thought that it would be somehow important in order to allow the time, because when you go to these places, it's not like you're in your studio and you're so comfortable that you can do anything you want. You can't. You have to negotiate, and the negotiation itself has it's form. It's form in itself that you have to somehow manipulate. So it somehow determines what you can produce within the space and the form and the texture that it takes. And sometimes some of the studio process is in both. If it's a building, it's been both inside and outside of the building at the same time. So the idea of going back and forth between this thing. So this back at the railway with the glass floor image I was showing you. So it's very important in terms of looking at this photograph or image in relation to, let's say, the dates in the early 1900s, also these the objects. Yeah. So producing within a space like this where there's already been a lot of history, but also there's a lot of like just the sheer objecthood of these spaces also somehow contributes to the vastness of the architecture and all that. Yeah, so residues from these spaces and how they contribute to the form of the work, archival drawings and images, structures which somehow body life but are buried within these brutalist modernist buildings that were built in the 50s. Coming back to the idea of the residue and the space and what it represents and the emptiness of it at later stages. So the installations themselves, this is one of the early images of some of the first installations that I did. And I think I was very in tune with this idea of having to produce a work that somehow had nothing to lose in the first place. Because the material is so rusty and it's so almost dead. It's like at a point that's at the verge of collapse. So there's nothing that you can really do to it that is truly harmful in a way. So some of the early works was about producing this work which would inhabit some of these spaces which you could somehow not experience. Because there's no way anyone is going to go into these gutters to look at this work of art. It's not going to happen. So I thought that it was somehow very brilliant in terms of going through all the labor process to produce something that somehow going to fit into like the human experience in terms of presenting it maybe on a certain ground level. Of course, later on, most of the projects I did were, but it was also very interesting in terms of using this as a starting point in terms of interrogating the forms that would come after. So some of them also occupied bridges that had newly been built, and the negotiations took really long time. All these projects were done during my MFA period. I think that's when I started doing these experiments. And Venice Lease 2 years ago was born specifically out of this particular image because it had newly been built and there were all these signs there out of bounds because people were not allowed to sell on the bridge because normally that's what we do. Because it's built over the old railway track and it's a market space now. So what do you expect people to do? They have to occupy the space. So I thought it was somehow interesting contradiction and paradox. So sometimes some of the titles that I gave to the images, to the works are very intentional in terms of the paradoxical nature of them. Yeah, so I went on to do this project, which is the university's museum. So it was one of the also early projects during the MFA. And I think that was when I started also doing like these projects within the interior, because when you're working within the interior, it also gives you a different time becomes also very different, because now you have to slow down upon it, and you now have to concentrate. It's almost, you almost treat it like some kind of a painting, because when it's outside, it's very different. Of course, the surface of the
the materials are very important, but when it's inside and you have to deal with it, with the climate, also because of the light and all that, I thought that it was very important to deal, to address the texture and other things a lot more.
So I think this was at the,
yeah, the Saatchi Gallery, that was in 2014. And there was another one at the Eli and the North Art Museum in Michigan. I think that was in 2015. Yeah. So going back to the projects, the independent projects, it also came back to this idea of working with structures and then having to deal with the structures before and after the occupation. So the idea of just supporting these images were important because looking at the image, you could somehow question yourself about what the idea of the occupation itself means, or what the intervention of these objects over the size. So I kind of, and most of these buildings, there are these specific buildings around Ghana. This, for instance, is the university library. Yeah, so it's a typical tropical modernist architecture. Yeah, so I think in 2014, when I was just about to graduate from my MFA, I think we were in Ghana. Sorry. You're allowed to do like a final presentation in terms of your projects. So I think this was the final work that I did. It was quite interesting then. I think it really gave me a really interesting view in terms of looking at the work, the painting quality of it, particularly given the fact that I had dedicated most of my time to study paint and paint itself and how the different forms that could come out from it. So the coming back to the silos again, yeah. So I think in as much as for me, I like to deal with the politics of, because art is political in its sense, but I don't label my work as political art. I think that the politics comes within the way you deal with the production, or the spaces that you choose to work with, or the forms that you choose to create, or how you think about the relationship of the audience. In relation to the work itself. It's been very strategic in terms of all the different sites that I've chosen to work with, and the relationship of these sites to other things which are around it. So this is
A building under, it's this luxury apartment, and in front of it has this social housing project that was built in the 60s, but was later sold.
So somehow I'm very much interested in how these relationships, different aesthetics are created and made. And sometimes they also exist in very different forms. So this was in Copenhagen in 2016, just last year. So coming back to the earlier forms of the work itself with the collaborators, and then collaborating on these buildings in Ghana, in the airport area. I think it's always very important in terms of looking at the physical production of the work itself, because it's made, the very foundation of the production itself is based on the idea of failure. It means that the collaborators that I work with, their point is that there is no given way of producing the artwork. The artwork is based on objects that have somehow already at the verge of collapse. And then you're working with people who somehow do not fit within the social context, within a certain period. At the same time, they are the very essence of life around, like they're the very essence of life itself, you know. So I thought that it was very, very interesting in terms of using this paradox as a means of production. And it's a very heavy contradiction in terms of looking at how
the work is produced and the space that it occupies and who the audiences are for. So taking very different forms and also in terms of looking at this relationship with other things, this relationship with the city, growing. So the forms and the shapes are very different, depending on whichever way you're looking at it. And sometimes it occupies multiple spaces at once. So this is a project, the exchange, which was about 22 different buildings, all at once. There's a film I will show at the end, which gives a much more, gives a different context. At this point, I'll just glance through some of the images. If there's something specific, I'll just mention. Yeah. So some of these, so this is the old Museum of Science and Technology. It was built in the early 60s, but it was never completed. So you can see the difference between the image in that one of them is new and the other one, this is just like a week later, the work begins to fall apart. It's because of the method of production. Yeah. The failure is already inscribed into the production process and I don't have to do it. It's somehow something that already exists that's within both the material and the production process. So it looks very dark, but from the inside it's actually very cool. Yeah, so this was at Venice Biennale 2 years ago. This was at in the old parliament where I decided to build these grain silos in the museum itself. Venice, it's important because the reason is that when I arrived at the Biennale to talk, to meet the director, you know, as an artist most of the time, because I was just finishing my MFA then, so as an artist, particularly because I was just 26 at that time, and it was very exciting. But for me, the good thing about myself is that I don't get overly excited about things. So when I got the invitation, I asked them, can I come and see this place? Because I've never been to Venice before. And a series of like emails, like making proposals and back and forth. And in the end, I realized that it was very important for me to go there in order to decide what work I was going to show there. And so in the end, they said the director was going to be there on a particular date. So I made a time and I traveled to Venice. So when I got there, I met the director and we had a series of long conversations. We ended up going through this space and the director said, maybe this space could work for you based on the conversations we've had. And I said, yes, actually when I came into the Biennale, I was actually thinking of this, but now that you said it, I think we can start from here. And he was like, oh, maybe we can start from one, we can look at one side of it. And I said, no, if it's one side, maybe it would just be like a painting. So maybe let's do both sides. But it was actually very enormous in terms of looking at it, because it was almost 300 meters. So like looking at the politics of guys in production, transportation, I said, I think we can do it. It took a really short time, like a few months, like three, 4 months, to produce the entire work. But I think that's the thing. There's always some kind of catapultic energy inside you, particularly when when you want to like do something, you do it at any length, given that you're very certain about it. So these are other images of other works recently, which I showed at YQ. It was really exciting, but I had also been doing experiments with it and also working with it as long as I've been working with the gene set, because my work deals a lot with relationship of objects and looking at the internal structures and the architecture of it. And I think what the gene sets are able to do in terms of the certain forms and meanings they convey, this other part of the work also does that in terms of looking at certain details of the work and looking at the architecture itself. So basically there are wooden objects that are used in they put shoe polish and things in it and they go around the city knocking them.
But interesting, the reason why I was interested in them is that it's a pure paradox. It's like a house in itself. The guys who use it, they don't have places to sleep. They sleep on the streets. And as they use it over and over again, they hit it so hard that over a period, the box gets destroyed and replaced parts of it, and then it gets destroyed and replaced parts in the right histories, dates and other things come through. And I thought it was somehow interesting in terms of looking at the combination of it in relation to spaces, like factories, objects that already exist, and occupying spaces within the old factories within. So this was at YQ in March, if I'm right. Yes. And this is currently in Brazil in an exhibition. So the point is that the work can be produced anywhere. So this was entirely produced in Brazil. And there are some that are really important details of it and that really also speak to the work. So I think this was in Kiev earlier this year. So the presentation of it always comes very different forms, and there also other aspects of it that deals with these archival qualities and maps. But most of the time, they are all actual objects that are very common. They are things that you somehow experience anyway. So this is the last image. This is a place in Greece. It's called Prosphilica. It was built in the 1920s. It came at a period when there were these bauhaus buildings that were built when a lot of Greeks had to migrate because of the Asian Minor crisis, and these images are other sites like marble sites that have been abandoned due to the Greek economy, fertilizer factories and other spaces. This is still an image of the building. During the last Olympics, the government was so ashamed of the building that they covered it with a picture of the Acropolis because they didn't want people to see the building when they came to see the, I think, we've all seen that in different ways. I think it's very important to somehow deal with our history in a way. So this is an image of the building before, early on in the 1920s. And now, as this exists, and a lot of things have grown around it, of course, over the last few decades, but I think I was more interested in the aesthetics through, because during the Second World War also, a lot of the building was reshaped. You can still find bullet holes and a lot of like grenade explosions on the buildings. So the traces of the history itself have somehow been ingrained into the place. And it's also one of the places where a lot of refugees who live within these places, there are a group of anarchists who've been working really hard in order to like maintain and keep it, because the state has been trying to somehow gentrify the place or tear it down. But we're trying to destroy it actually to build a park and keep two of the buildings as a refugee museum. And I was like, why would you keep destroying the buildings where the refugees are and keep one as a museum? It doesn't make sense. So but you have a lot of people living within this space. People who once had work that lost their work but somehow lived here, they use their everyday working skills, they are engineers or like electricians, to somehow fix the place. So I was very interested in how all these social interactions and things could somehow like contribute towards building a certain kind of place or economy in a way. So I guess I did a lot of photographic work of things that were happening in like everyday life and work. That was the thing that somehow influenced the work, which happened in the Parliament Square and Sintagma, where we were. We used there as the site of production. So the Parliament Square itself, where the protests and everything happened, what happens when it's occupied by the very objects that have somehow been as a result of the global transactions that have also contributed to the collapse of the economy and all that. And sometimes it's also very interesting in terms of the image on the right is one on the last day when we did the performance.
and there was a protest. There was supposed to be a protest by a Kurdish group, and the police suddenly took over the space. So if you look at the two images in terms of how the line of the state and authority somehow almost shut the image in a certain way, also through the space, it was something that I kept on thinking about and looking at. So I was thinking of what people were thinking about. So we got, we're very lucky to get for our request to be accepted by the state to take drone images over the parliament. So by courtesy of the Greek people, so this image was very important to me when I was planning this work, because I thought, because the idea was to make this work within the square, but it wouldn't be so visible. And through the drone image, it almost looks like it's staying within the square. And anytime you see like a picture of a revolution, maybe through a square, you always see thousands and thousands of bodies. But these materials, whether they are just 5 or 10, have been through countless number of places around the world. And I think that it embodies a lot more than just the physical body, in a way. It embodies architecture, it embodies a lot more other things, you know. So I thought that even just a tiny bit of it could somehow represent some of these like imageries that you see, even on a much more global scale. So the performances went beyond different spaces. So I think this is the last image, finally. And it's, sorry, I like to show a lot of images because it gives a context into the practice. This is the work in Documenta. So a lot of the images that you saw from Sintagma in terms of the Parliament Square and also from the factory in Kassel, a lot of them were somehow worked through all these spaces to finally occupy this building. And this building is a historical 19th century building that was during the time of the Grimm brothers. And one of them is currently, one of the buildings is the Court of Refugee Appeal. And one of them is the museum. So the refugee appeal, it was actually quite interesting when we had to get permits for this building, because the Minister of Justice in Germany said that we would only give you this permit if you decide, if you do a presentation for the courthouse and tell us exactly what your project is about. And I said, well, that's very easy. I think I can do that I can do that. And yeah, we met also with all the judges to actually talk about the significance of the work and what it meant in relation to the architecture and the space itself. And of course, there's always also, what's the name, fears, because it's a refugee, it's a court for refugee appeal. They were a bit afraid that if anyone was denied any asylum thing, and they could just maybe set the work on fire, and that could affect the building. So there was a lot of like looking at, let's say, cautionary measures and all that. And sometimes all those things affect the art work in terms of what it does, particularly when it's in such a public space and it's with a material that seems to be a bit fragile and very volatile in its at the same time. Yeah, so those are some of the things, maybe through the questions and answers, through the question period, there's a specific thing. There are a lot of things I didn't mention because normally this is, I've gone through actually like 5 years of work of different ideas altogether, trying to crumble it into one. Normally I'll just talk about one specific thing, but I thought it was somehow important to like spread the entire practice. So I hope I haven't bored you so much, thank you.
The monumentality of the the feeling of the monument, of walking into that space. And if you are talking about the kind of if you're talking about kind of global nature, is it to do with invoking the kind of in the space, the size of the problem or something like that. And also because I didn't see the work in Venice, Biennale, I was wondering what that passage actually was that you were covering.
The work in Venice, to start with us, it was just a passage. I think it had never been used in the history of the Biennale for over 120 years. And one side of the corridor belongs to the Biennale, and the other side belongs to the Navy. So somehow the Biennale had to go through, had to negotiate for it. But it was good because it somehow reintroduced that same space that people who had been familiar with for years as just a corridor into a space that could somehow potentially embody a certain work. And also because the work, it could be outside, I don't really mind, anything could happen to it. So it was actually good to present it within that context. And particularly also coming from Ghana and doing all those independent projects, it somehow felt like a shame to be able to do something as important as Venice and just end up doing the work within a room. I thought it was important to somehow make this point about what the work was about. And the first question about the sashi and the scale, it's not, for me, it's not really about the global problem per se. But I think, because sometimes my work comes in really small forms, and sometimes it comes in really large forms. Most of the time, honestly, it comes in large forms. I think it's also because most of the spaces that I've been interested in are already, like, they're very large in size already. And it actually takes a lot of small, detailed work to be able to make these large installations. So it takes a long time, because some of the works, it takes at least a year to do, because the independent projects, they take quite a long time to produce. So I think I like more to concentrate on the labor aspect and labor intensity of it. Because I have there's a problem I have with monuments in terms of what they do. And for me, the paradox about the work is that it's very monumental, but at the same time, the work is almost a certain kind of critique towards the idea of monumentality itself. Yeah, so it's, it is what it is.
Hi, I mean, thanks for your talk. I wanted to ask a bit more about the labor aspect of your work and linking it to what you're talking about monumentality, where it's really about architecture and monuments, where it kind of consciously tries to like invisibilize the labor that goes into producing them. But then in your works, it's like, on one hand, because of the aesthetic of it, like when you have the two buildings, it kind of equalized them because it's talking about the same thing. But on the other hand, the amount of labor it takes to make them is completely visible because of the scale of them. And I'm just wondering also about, you called it to be one of the collaborators, and I'm wondering about that relationship to you and what that really entails and what that means, and why you choose to call them collaborators, and how you find them, how you work with them, and what that process is like.
Thank you. The collaborators, they are made up of a lot of different people, men, women, a lot of young men and women, as I showed in the earlier image. I don't think you've ever seen the film. Would you be bored to see a film? Yeah, it's very short, and then it will. Yeah, I think films are a lot more visual. I guess it will answer a lot of these. It will answer some of these questions. Do you prefer? Okay. I think that would answer your question directly, and then it might answer some questions really directly.
Yeah.
Yeah, sometimes you can, yeah, you have to deal with the realities of these things in terms of what the work actually requires for production. Yeah, and as I said before, of course it's not very general because both the female and male characters that I work with, they do all the roles interchangeably. But sometimes, for instance, and also they are these couples that I work with who work on these construction sites. So I somehow also understand the form. Because as an artist, I have an idea in terms of what I do because I go to the site over and over, I make drawings, sketches, I study the wind. I work with an architect, but at the end of the day, when the physical thing comes and you're trying to organize the labor, it's also about how to manage that specific population in terms of how that work is going to come together, you know? So there are a lot of pragmatic decisions that have to be made within the site, and also very important because you're occupying a space which is already occupied. It's not as if these spaces are abandoned. They are not. There are people living there, people work there. This is a theater, which they're having performances and other things in. And you've been given the chance to deal with the space. So are you just going to go ahead and do anything you want? No, you can't. You somehow have to carefully calculate these things. And particularly when you're working within a space where there's a very limited amount of history in terms of how practices like this have been made over the years, you somehow have to be very careful in terms of you make and what you decide to do and what you decide not to do, because you have to be very responsible for the people that you work with, yeah, and not just putting them in any kind of position at all. In terms of the way the idea of the urban space or the city is constructed, it somehow already does certain injustices to people who live, occupy, and help contribute to the spaces. Answer your question. Yeah, so the point was just that it's very plural. There are a lot of different people involved. And all these people I've met through the work itself, through conversations of it. It was also one of the questions that I kept asking myself was, what kind of work did I want to produce as an artist, you know? I feel very much, I'm not a nationalist or anything, but the reason why I've stayed in Ghana and worked there over the years is because it's been very important in terms of being part of a generation that physically contributes to the reshaping of certain ideals and, yeah, whether meaning through form, aesthetics, yeah. And it's very ideological in terms of how people think and how people respond to things. And when you work with these specific individuals and characters, sometimes you realize that through, because you know, history has a way of really dealing with the human mind, because at some point your mind has been subject to maybe a sequence of things or thinking in such a way that you instinctively you wouldn't think or do otherwise, you know. And I think it's very important because once you start working with them periodically, sometimes when we are having conversations, there are certain really interesting things they say in terms of observations they've made in the city or even their relationship with other things or other people. And I think it's very important, particularly when you exercise some of these production methods and you end up going to theaters, airport areas, railway stations, old bridges, like even areas where they've never possibly been before. Because when we went to the railway station, something which was just very simple as a railway in a place, it almost seemed like we had entered into a science fiction adventure. Because it seemed really magical, but at the same time, it was something that was really, really fundamental in terms of human history. So I think all these things are very important, and I think I'm more interested in creating work that somehow creates a shift within these paradigms, rather than just creating a work that I think that as an artist, I feel very comfortable with. Sometimes the very process itself is very uncomfortable, but I think that's when it's even more exciting, because it means that history can somehow be looked at differently. Yeah, so I think it's a very good point about using the opposite of what you wouldn't want as a starting point to investigate. Maybe it's just nonsensical, but it's sometimes good to be a bit nonsensical. Yeah.
We were wondering over here at the end what city you were looking at.
Which?
At the end of the film, what city?
That is in Accra.
Hi, thanks for your talk again. So, I have two questions again. Like, my first one is that you said that you grew up political. Yeah, from what your answer to the last question, you're very interested in like the shifting like ideologies.
Yeah.
And for me that seems very political. So I just wondered like what exactly was your hesitance in calling your work that, work political? And secondly, it's a more practical question, which is just who are the workers who sewed together the sacks in like Greece, for example? Who
are
the people who make
the work? Yeah, I start with the second one, I think. Yeah, in Greece, they were just people who had signed up because it was a call, an open call. So they were both students, art students, some of them were choreographers, dancers. Some of them were also just people that had met their friends. Yeah, and also during the projects, the performances, it's open. So anyone is open to participate in it. So a lot of people just came and worked on it for the project. And the political aspect of it. Can you repeat the question a bit? Sorry.
Earlier on, you said that you wouldn't call your work political.
Yeah.
And but then some of the things you're saying, I mean, to me, they seem very political, this importance of shifting, that your work has to be shifting ideologies. Ghana. So I wondered why it was that even though that is so important to your work, you were so hesitant about calling your work political.
Yeah, I think it's also because within art, I think sometimes some of these terms are somehow misused, you know. When artists always say, oh, I'm very political. And no, I think that art in itself is somehow already political when you somehow deal with it on a certain level. Even the choice, I think choice is political in terms of what the choice you decide to make, to choose one space over the other. I could have chosen that I didn't want to work with any of the collaborators I wanted to work with, and I would only go on to work with people who are experts in sewing. Or I would go on to work with, let's say, only museums. Or I wouldn't show my work in any space because I felt that it wasn't artistic enough, you know? Or maybe I wouldn't even choose the particular materials I'm working with because they're preferred to collapse. But no, I would choose these which are preferred to collapse because there is something about it. And that was what I was referring back to earlier in terms of the historical aspect of your work, in terms of looking at the idea of a certain revolution or certain field potential when you look at all these different spaces, whether being it from the image that I showed of the Greek the housing units prosimica, which is very important in terms of looking at how people can come together in order to sustain life,
or looking at, let's say, even the railway station, where a lot of work still happens with the workers and all that, or looking at the places where I collect the objects from. A lot of other different other things. I think, for me, the idea of the potential, which is somehow been, it's somehow hidden behind the failure. So it's very difficult to somehow see it in a way. But for me, making the decision to work with that thing, which is somehow unknown, which is very dark, but at the same time very promising when you think about it within a much more futuristic sense. That is what is that is where the politics is, and it's not within a, it's not actually within a certain kind of conversation where you would try as much as possible to reason, you know, that thing. I try to have this kind of confrontation. I think it's already there, you know, and the ideology of it, the point about it is that through the decisions and the choices about negotiating with one institution and one person over the other and involving certain individuals in your work and then opening up certain dialogues and all that, that's where the politics becomes play and become interesting. It changes the foundations of things, the relationship between people, the relationship between objects, it intensifies things, even if it's not known immediately. It's something that has a long-lasting effect in terms of looking at idea of imagery, aesthetics. Yeah, so it goes quite a long way, I must say. That's why I'm very hesitant to saying that it's political. I think it's there. And sometimes you can see it within artists' practices in terms of the choice they make. And for me, the choice is always important. Yeah. And global politics, we see it all the time. Yeah, neoliberal politics, very terrible. People do one thing and they say the other, oh, the politics of this. No, the politics is where fundamentally you make certain choices which do not contradict the thing that the very thing you're talking about at the same time, you know. So I think we somehow have to revisit these things and then think through them.
Can I ask you one more question? We're going over time.
Yes.
So good. Okay. I'm really interested in when you were in Germany and in the courthouse and had to make a presentation. Like, to me, it seems like you had like the ultimate critique. It's like artist versus like non-artist, like legal admin, like big shots who actually make decisions about people's lives and the things that you're thinking about. What did that feel like? Because I think it's really important. And how can we make those things happen more often?
The conversation in Germany, I think I've had many of these conversations already before with like different institutions in global politics. It was a really interesting moment to somehow, because in talking about the work in this sense, it somehow also came, made them realize sometimes the decisions they themselves as institutional body in terms of judiciary make, because they have the ability to decide whether people are accepted or people stay or leave and all these things. Yeah. So somehow, I think I was more interested in talking to them about the poetics of history through objects and specific spaces. So I spoke a lot more about the history of the railway and also the connection that it had to the object that I'm using now to Germany, for instance, and how we could look at, we could learn from some of these histories, you know. And at the end of the day, of course, they had their own questions, because, of course, when you're in Europe and you've been so much exposed to different forms of art, you somehow, because in 1994, when Christo did the Reichstag in Berlin, there's always that memory of it till date. So they were somehow very much interested in how the work we're going to do had a certain kind of the relationship with that to that specific history. So it was also like an opportunity to somehow readdress the point about the looking at things. Yeah. And the fact that we somehow can reduce everything down to what we experience through our eyes, and we have to somehow take time to reflect upon these things in the context of decision making. The fact that we see something doesn't mean that's what it is, and that's what it summarizes the form about that entity or object. So yeah, it was, I guess I try, because I'm just an artist, you know. And of course, I'm still in school, trying to do this PhD. And I don't think of myself as an intellectual in any sense. I only think of myself as someone who constantly wants to reflect on how the images I make and how crucial and important they are. I think to me they are. So as best as possible to let other people understand the points that I'm trying to make. And I think they somehow understood aspects of it. So it's quite a fruitful discussion.
Mm.
And hopefully in the future there will be more people say, yeah. So anyway, thank you. It's been very, I've been very honored to be here. So thank you very much for your attendance.